The cast are assembled, the props are in place, the audience are seated, and for his presence we wait. For tonight is a story about love that came down, about shepherds and wise men and a king without crown, of stables, of donkeys, of heavenly hosts, of innkeepers and prophecies and a villain that boasts. For tonight, let us tell you of a story anew. As you follow each door and follow the story right through. And as we sit and remember that first Christmas night, may the joy of his presence fill you tonight.
As the promise of a Saviour comes into the land, foretold by the prophets and writings of old, take courage, dear friend, as this story unfolds.
For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulders, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, to establish and to uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time forth and forevermore. Thank you.
too holds the truth of the sin we must send. When governed by Romans gods, people started to fret. Its empire is great. Its empire is vast. It rules with authority forecasted to last. But remember the promise of long, long ago, of a promised Messiah and hope evermore.
The royal line of David is like a tree that has been cut down, but just as new branches sprout from a stump, so a new king will arise from among David's descendants.
It is the year 4 BC. A new leader, Emperor Augustus, now rules the throne. To many, he is a god. Some even call him Savior, Bringer of Peace. The strength of Rome is at its peak, but the Roman Empire is so vast that its people are unaccounted. So Augustus calls for a census. Everyone must return to the town of their birth to be numbered, so the empire's true size might be measured. It is indeed the greatest civilization in human history.
I'm warming up the crowd, getting them on my side.
I mean, what are you doing dressed like that?
You said I'd meet you here as a gladiator, so here I am. What do you think?
A Roman gladiator? You meant to be on duty for Augustus tonight.
I searched a gladiator costume and this is what I found.
It's not a costume, idiot. It's a uniform. He's going to kill you if he sees you like this.
He might see the funny side of it. I could take him on, see who the ultimate champion is.
Are you kidding me? This isn't a joke. It's not like your mum's going to kill you for eating the Christmas sweets for Christmas. It's like stone cold dead. Dead in a land, stone by a crowd, kind of dead. Oh. You may get out of here before somebody sees you.
But in Judea, a far-flung outpost, civil unrest stirs. The people of Israel struggle under the tyrannical reign of the evil King Herod. In the face of his harsh rule, the Jewish people desperately hold on to their hope of a true Messiah. A Messiah foretold over 300 times in the ancient readings. But God has been silent for 400 years.
Three reveals who God chose to lead and to guide this miraculous babe with hope in his eyes. Descended from David, this guy was for real, a carpenter, follower, Joseph by name. Mary's line is unclear, but we know that her heart treasured up all the things she had heard from the start.
But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favour with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. And of his kingdom there will be no end."
Thank you.
But as he considered these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, do not fear to take Mary as your wife, for that which is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins.
Door 4 tells the plight of this new family. As Herod sends out his crazy decree, to Bethlehem quickly they must depart, a donkey for transport, and heavy in heart.
And Joseph also went up from Galilee, from the town of Nazareth to Judea, to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be registered with Mary, his betrothed, who was with child.
Door 5 moves us on with our story tonight. And I feel for those shepherds who had such a friend. As angels descending, brought from above, news of a miracle, covered with love.
And in the same region, there were shepherds out in the field, keeping watch over flock by night. And an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were filled with great fear. And the angel said to them, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people, for unto you is born this day in the city of David a Saviour, who is Christ Lord. And this will be a sign for you: you will find a baby wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger."
This way, guys.
I think we've outrun them this time.
I think you're right.
Hey, guys, I have an idea. Let's play hide and seek.
Slow crowd tonight. Hang on. It seems like we've got a slow crowd tonight. Try that line again.
Okay, here goes. Let's have a game of hide and sheep.
Get it? Get it? Because we're sheep, we play hide and... Oh, never mind. I lost it on you lot.
Hang on. I've got one. Let me see if I could get a laugh out of them.
With you, a laugh is not always guaranteed.
What washing machine brand do sheep always buy?
I don't know. Which washing machine brand sheep always buy?
Whirlpool.
I would just like to point out there are other washing machine brands, and Lisburn Elim do not sell the indoor Whirlpool unless they are willing to give us free electrical goods.
Hang on. I've got a good one.
Go on then.
What do you call a sheep with no legs?
I don't know. What do you call a sheep with no legs?
A cloud.
I don't get it.
You're as bad as this lot.
Okay, I got a good one. What was the evil sheep's plan? I don't know. What was the evil sheep's plan?
To rule the world.
Rule the world. Ah!
Okay, my turn. I've got a good one. What did the deaf barber say to the sheep?
What did the deaf barber say to the sheep?
I can't shear you.
Shear you? That's brilliant.
Tonight.
For you maybe, but that's just old age.
Hey, that's enough of you.
Let's get these guys rounded up.
Looks like a good spot over there.
Ah, that's a nice wee spot.
Kappa?
Lovely jubbly. Jamie, you're very quiet tonight.
Do you guys feel like there is strange feeling in the air tonight?
Did you have beans again for dinner?
Oh no, not that kind of feeling. Oh, hang on. Nothing's better now.
That absolutely stinks. I am banning you from eating beans ever again.
I take it the strange feeling has gone now?
Aye, straight up my nostrils.
No, it's hard to explain. It just means if something's about to happen.
Well, it better not be a repeat of what just happened.
Are you forgetting that this is Bethlehem and nothing exciting ever happens here?
The most exciting thing that happens is when a wolf appears.
It's okay, it's all clear, you can sit back down.
I know you think I'm being rude, but I just have this sense of anticipation.
What now?
Anticipation and excitement in my belly.
Right, that's it. Sit over there. We can't handle another one of your anticipations tonight, thanks. At least we can be guaranteed a quiet night now that he's over there.
As we move to door 6, we can clearly see God's wonderful plan unfolding so beautifully. Clothed in the splendors of heaven's delight, we see angels appear in the dead of the night. Glory to God in the highest we sing, and peace on earth we hear praises ring.
And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly hosts, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among those with whom he is pleased."
I love this dress. Is it new?
To you, yes. To my hubby, no.
Is it one of those outfits you've had in the cupboard for years?
That's it, exactly. You just have to rip the labels off quick pronto.
Where are you going to hide them?
The only place he never looks.
Where's that?
The iron basket.
Hey, look sharp, here she comes, clipboard at the ready.
I don't know who died and made her supervisor. She's so bossy.
Wonder where we're headed to tonight.
I hope it's not the old angels home again. Good evening, ladies. I hope you're all in fine voice and ready to go.
So where are we headed tonight then?
I hope it's somewhere glam.
Is it Gabriel's birthday? He throws a great party. No, ladies. Tonight is the most important night of your angel careers. That sounds intriguing. It's been too quiet here for the last 400 years.
It's an announcement. I love an announcement. Bringing great news is my favourite.
It is an announcement! Calm down, ladies, calm down. Tonight, we are going to Bethlehem.
Did you just say Bethlehem?
Yes.
Is that the one in Judea?
That's the one.
Is it that little shabby outpost? Do you know the one with the shepherds and the sheep?
Right again.
Oh no, it can't be. This dress is not made for Bethlehem. This dress is made for Paris, New York, or even Milan.
Well, Bethlehem is where that dress is headed. Now, chop chop, ladies, into formation.
What's the big announcement up in Bethlehem?
A few sheep being born? Of a kind.
It's not.
It is.
No way.
Oh, yes. Right, ladies, now calm down. You're too excitable. Too excitable. We have a job to do. Okay, right. Now, our mission is we have to go and do an announcement, okay? Now, the archangel has gone on ahead of us, and he has gone to pronounce the birth. And our job is to host, a heavenly host, to proclaim the good news that the baby is born, so there can be no doubt that the baby is the Son of God. Now, quickly, ladies, into formation and let's warm up. After me. La 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 la. Take it up a step. La 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 la. Okay, formation quickly.
Let's stand. Seven opens. The scene it unfolds is the one of a couple with no room to call home. Traveling to Bethlehem after Roman decree, Joseph goes door to door for his new family. No room, they tell him, no room in the inn, but there's a stable with a donkey and an ox they can stay in.
And while they were there, the time came for her to give birth. And she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger because there was no place for them in the inn.
Imagine turning up at this time, looking at a room. I mean, it's well past my check-in date. It's also the busiest time we've ever had. What with Augustus ordering the census, we're packed to the rafters. Don't get me wrong, the money's good. And if I had anywhere else to squeeze them in, I would have. I'm not one to turn away a paying customer, unless I really must.
The cheek. I mean, what kind of establishment do they think I am running? I heard rumours that the baby wasn't even his. What? I can't have people like that around here. What would it do to my reputation? I'm a standing member of society and will not have my name brought down by riffraff.
I have rooms, if any of you need them.
But my loyalty's like with the Roman Empire. I mean, just look what a good job Augustus is doing. He's keeping a firm hand on things. We have building taking place, baths at the height of luxury, and to top it all off, he's a dreamboat. I have no room for Jews and others who don't bow to Augustus.
I am not a hospital. Did it look like I ever woke off then above my door? I couldn't have them coming here. She looked ready to burst. The poor girl needs a midwife, not a long journey on a donkey. I sent her down the road to see if you could find someone to help.
I felt so sorry for them. They had no choice to come with her so far along. Augustus demanded it, and we all know what happens if we go against his rules. I didn't have a single room, but she looked so close to tears. My heart broke for them, so I showed them the stable. I mean, it's cozy, but it isn't exactly private, what with the cows, sheep, and a few chickens. They just seemed glad to have somewhere to lay their heads for the night.
Dorian slowly opens, the story unfolds, with a king working out how to tighten his hold. He wants to be worshipped, he wants to control. He's mad, bad, and furious at the news of the birth. A new king's not welcome to rival his throne.
Now, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, saying, "Where is he who has been born king of the Jews? For we saw his star when it rose, and have come to worship him." When Herod the king heard this, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him.
People sit here murmuring amongst each other. Your king is walking amongst you. Worship your king. Bow before your king, or my wrath will come upon you. These magi, they dare to travel from lands of afar to speak of one who will challenge my power, my crown, my domain. They think they will challenge me? I'm troubled. I'm angry. I am starting to fret. This will not stand. He won't take what I own. I must find this young babe before it clears my throne!
Door 9 brings visitors from far, far away, bringing gifts, come to worship. The Lord's voice they obeyed. They have followed the star from the east to the west, taking care to avoid Herod's slimy request. They know this child's worth and have taken a vow to return home avoiding the king who rules now.
After listening to the king, they went on their way, and behold, the star that they had seen when it rose went before them until it came to rest over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced exceedingly with great joy.
Hey, wait up, hold on.
Is he still following us?
I thought we had lost him halfway through the dessert.
Here, you have to give it to him. He is persistent.
Aye, you guys walk fast.
It's your short legs.
I nearly lost you at the last well.
If it hadn't been for Bob putting it up on Facebook, saying that he'd booked you in Herod's palace here, I'd still be wandering the desert otherwise.
I told you he's not to befriend him on Facebook. Ach, he wore me down. And I gave in. Sure, it's only Facebook. What harm will it do?
What harm? The type of harm where you can track us down and follow us when we're trying to give him the slip.
Can I come with you, please?
No.
Oh, please.
You can't come.
Why not?
Because there were only three wise men.
Sorry, I would just like to point out I prefer to identify as a king rather than a wise man. I don't want to be in that type of stereotype.
Okay, there were three kings in the story.
Actually, I would prefer to identify as a magi. I feel it's actually more scriptural accurate.
That's about the only thing scripturally accurate in this play. Fine, regardless of how you choose to identify, wise man, king, or magi, there were only three.
Who said?
The Bible said, the undisputed heavyweight champion. God's word.
No, it doesn't.
Actually, it does. I've read it before.
You show me where in the Bible it says that there were three wise men.
Kings. Magi.
Enough. Would you two wise up? Wait till I get my Bible out here. Do I have a look? Let me have a look. Where's my phone? It's in here somewhere. Right. Matthew chapter 2, verse 1. When Jesus was born in the town of Bethlehem, at the time of Herod the king, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem.
Doesn't say how many there were.
Just hold on a minute. I've got the King James version here. None of that ESV nonsense that your boy in the front here has. Yes, where was I? It's slipping.
That's a first.
This will sort out the sheep from the Arsenal supporters. Now, when Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, in the days of Herod the king, there came wise men from the east to Jerusalem.
Ah, still doesn't say how many there were.
No, I'm pretty sure it does say there's three of us. Oh, sorry. Three gifts means three of us.
Yes, wise one, with your proper version of the Bible. What's it say about the gifts?
Let me just have a wee look here. Can I borrow your glasses, Lofty?
There you go.
Lofty.
That's better. Now, where was I? Yes, here we are. Matthew chapter 2, verse 11. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented him with gifts, gold, frankincense, and myrrh.
There you go. Three gifts, three wise men.
Kings?
Magi.
Will you two shut up? You're worse than my kids.
But it only says that there was three gifts. Not there weren't three visitors.
Are you sure?
Well, he does have a point.
Maybe he could come then.
Now hold on a second.
Oh, here goes Scrooge.
Now, will we have to share our gifts, this boy over here?
Listen, there's no way I'm sharing my gift. This cost me a fortune.
I know, sure, didn't we go to the unwrap shop to buy our gifts? See your man, Trevor? He saw us coming up the road in our camels, and he hiked the prices up.
And I asked Trevor to do a wee, 3-for-2 offer. You know, the way boots do. for their Christmas gifts.
That's a, that was a really good idea. We've got to split the bill.
Oh. Now, as you know, Stephen, this is what your boy said to me, Trevor. And you won't believe this.
Oh, well, he's my father-in-law.
Well, I'm sure he said this to you a number of times, Stephen. He says to me, go and sling your hook, mate.
That's exactly the words, yeah.
I thought that. He says, my goods are very competitively priced.
I know. Sure, he charged me an arm and three legs for my frankincense. No way am I sharing that with anyone.
Well, listen, it's an if, and it's a big if. If we let you come, what can you bring?
Oh, I've nothing to bring.
What? No gift? This is the prophesied king we are going to visit. You cannot come empty-handed.
But it only says there was three specific gifts in the Bible, so I don't have to bring anything.
Hang on here, chappies. This star is moving again. So it is. So, I think with this boy Herod, he gives me the heebie-jeebies. So he does. So I think we should get on our camels and get out of here.
Yeah, I have to agree, guys. I really didn't like his tone. I really don't think he wants to worship the new king.
Here, let's make a move, guys. Come on.
Does that mean I can come?
Well, if we say no, are you still going to follow us?
Oh, yes.
Well, listen, don't get too close to my camel or you'll get a nasty surprise.
And nobody does.
Door 10 brings the wonderful scene to light as the beautiful babe is born into the night. A king with no robes, no crown or no throne, but whose heavenly kingdom will reign evermore. His birth brings hope as God's promise unfolds, and this king swaddled up in God's glorious love.
And going into the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother, and they fell down and worshipped him. Then, opening their treasures, they offered him gifts, gold, frankincense, and myrrh.
Together, king, pa-ra-pa-pum-pum, ra-pa-pum-pum. I play for you, pa-rum-pum-pum-pum. On my drum.
And moves her story along a few days, and to the temple Mary brings her boy to give praise. But wait, two are waiting who have given their lives to waiting on the news of this miraculous life.
And when they had performed everything according to the law of the Lord, they returned into Galilee, to their own town of Nazareth. And the child grew and became strong, filled with wisdom, and the favour of God was upon him.
When I woke up that morning, I had an overwhelming urge to go to the temple, but I couldn't get there fast enough. You know, when it was like, it seems as if everything around you is going in slow motion, but you are hurtling like a steam train. As soon as they stepped inside the temple, I knew. Do you ever get that feeling deep down in your guts? I just knew. This was a feeling like no other, one that stops you in your tracks, make you breathe deep and be still. This was the Messiah. I was told by the Holy Spirit that I would not die before I'd seen him. And there he is in front of me. Baby in arms. But I knew, you know when you're in the presence of God. I held him. This tiny babe, beautiful, peaceful, still, but surrounded by glory. I praised my heavenly Father and said, Master, now you are dismissing your servant in peace. According to your word, for my eyes have seen your salvation.
The moment the young couple entered the temple, I knew there was something different. Yes, in appearance, they looked no different to any other couple presenting their newborns in the temple. And yet something significant was happening before my very own eyes. You see, day and night I had spent in the temple seeking the Most High, fasting and praying for the deliverance of Israel. And here he was, brought before me as a babe in arms. Here in my advanced years, God had revealed to me that this baby boy was the promised Messiah, foretold of old by the prophets gone before me. and all I could do was lift my voice in my heart and give thanks. I had beheld him, the Savior of the world.
Door 12 is the last we will open tonight. We've heard of the Magi and angels' delight. We've heard of the donkey, the sheep, and the inn. But your story's not over. It can only begin when you open your heart and let his light in. We tell of his love and his grace just for you, and his welcome to offer you life bright and new. So as we come to a close, we must all agree, Christmas isn't Christmas without mentioning the tree. Cut down from its glory, and sculpted to make a cross on a hill where he died for your sake. So this Christmas season, let's remember the babe, born pure and holy, and all for your sake.
When the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his Son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law, so that they may receive adoption as sons.
Church of Christ was born.